Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the webinar, What the Shingo Model Adds to Your Organization's Pursuit of Excellence. I'm Dominic Bria, and I'm the one who gets to do the marketing here at the Shingo Institute. During the course of the webinar, just go ahead and type in your questions, and we'll get to as many of those as we can during the course of the webinar. Also, if we don't get to your question, we'll get to as many as we can afterward. And so go ahead and just reply to our emails with your question, and we'll do our best to answer those. During the course of the webinar, you're going to hear our presenters refer to a conference, and probably most of you know that that conference is the upcoming International Shingo Conference. And to get a really good experience with the Shingo model and see others who are using it successfully and have used it successfully and rub shoulders with them and hear them speak, that's a terrific place to do that. Our presenters today are some leaders of the Shingo Institute, Sean Barker, who is the Assistant Executive Director, and Dr. Gerhard Plannert, who is the Director of Executive Education. And so I'm going to let them introduce themselves very, very quickly. Gentlemen, are you ready?
Ready. Good morning.
All right.
I'm Sean Barker. I'm as introduced by Dom. I work here at the Institute. Just to give you a little bit of background, I had a career in retail operations before coming back and getting my MBA, and through that process of getting my MBA, became acquainted with the Shingo Institute in 1998, and have been here in one capacity or another ever since, and enjoying the transformation that we're going through as well.
I'm Gerhard Plannert. I have been playing several different roles. I was an academic for the tenured full professor for 12 years, and the last 20 years did a variety of different consulting assignments. During that time, I've cranked out about 18 books on various aspects of the lean and the things that we're talking about here. So I'll give it back to Sean to start the conversation.
So we've got some slides that are going to be brought up in front of you, and Gerhard and I will be here to the side talking about them. And of course, our intent is to give you an overview and understanding of the model and where the Shingo Institute is at, and what we're currently working on, and some of the things that will come in the future. But I just wanted to bring this up because I know when we brought the Institute up and made the change to the logo, some people asked about what happened to the prize and that. And of course, that's still alive and well and thriving. And the Shingo Institute is the home of the Shingo Prize. The logo is current. We use it when we refer to the prize itself. But we went to the Institute, as you can imagine, in the academic environment that we're in. We're beginning to do a lot more research into the things that we'll talk about today. And our hope, of course, is to get into publishing some more of these. This is a lot of what Gerhard's working on these days, and to be able to deliver more value to you. And that was the change that we made to the Institute, and we'll talk about several aspects of that here as we go through the next hour or so. And hopefully we'll answer your questions. I'm sure there'll be many out there. We answer several of them every day. And then the John M. Huntsman School of Business is what we are a part of. That we have always been a part of the Huntsman School of Business here at Utah State University. We've moved to different locations. We're not actually in the Huntsman School anymore, but we are a part of them, no different than any other department would be. So that's kind of the relationship between these three logos. Some of you may recognize the old Shingo Prize a logo that is still in use, as I said, and doing well, and our new one, the Shingo Institute. So, but let's get into really what we wanted to talk about today, and that is the model and kind of where it came from and where it's at and where it's going. If many of you will remember the old model, and when I refer to the old model, it's pre-2008. We introduced this model in 2008, in January of 2008. But what's most important is why we developed this new model. And the reason behind developing the new model is we found that a lot of the organizations that we worked with at the time were struggling with sustaining the results that they were getting. And as we all know, we're all in this game to get great results. So we started looking at this and looking at the organizations and went back and dug into a lot of the readings that were available at the time and the publications, and that we began to discover why some of these organizations, the culture was not actually changing, why they were able to use tools and use systems, and in some cases very well, and get results, get great results, but over time these results would waver, and in some cases we'd go back and be redoing the transformation that had been done in the first place, rebuilding systems, relearning tools, and so forth. So if you look at the top of our model, and we're going to have several descriptions of this today, you'll see that's where the guiding principles reside. Some of you may remember that we had a house of principles that went along with this model beforehand, and for the sake of simplification, and actually where those principles reside, we put the dimensions into the guiding principles and where they were at. Now there's really two portions of this, right? It's our individual embedding of these principles within ourselves, and then how do we do that for our organization? You know, how do we make these principles embedded or evident in our organization? And as we talk about this model this morning, we'll cover that. I'll bring up some of our insights that we've learned here in just a minute. So when you look at those dimensions, these dimensions are what house the principles that we talk about in the Shingo Institute. And what we found out about principles was very interesting, because principles, as we know from some of Covey's work, are timeless, they're universal, right? They're self-evident. Self-evident meaning that we don't invent them, right? They can be discovered, but we certainly don't invent them. So they hold over time. It doesn't seem to matter where we go in the world. These principles and the behaviors that go along with them, that I'll talk about, are consistent. They govern the consequences of what can happen in our organization. And because they govern those consequences, you can go into organizations and based on the behaviors that you're observing, you can actually begin to predict some of the things that are going on within the organization. That gets into the assessment part that we use in the Shingo Prize. So you can now see each piece of the model and where it evolved from, but let's continue on a little bit and talk about some of the insights that we discovered. As you look at the model, you'll see the arrows in the model depicting the relationships between tools, systems, principles, and results. And I want to make absolutely clear that it's the results in the end that we have to deliver. Our question and what we look at is, how are we getting those results? Because how we're getting those results begins to tell us the sustainability about those results over the long term. So I mean, we can sit here all day long and talk about principles and behaviors and that, and if it's not getting us results, you're not going to want to listen to us for very long. Results are extremely important to our model. So as we look at some of these relationships, we look down at tools, and we know we have to have tools. We have to have the tools that are actually going to begin to achieve those results. The question is, what systems are those tools supporting, right? So our systems begin to select those tools, right? And when we talk about aligning and driving principles, when we talk about driving a principle, we're talking about driving a behavior. And that brings us to one of our first insights, and that is that ideal results require ideal behaviors. Right? So ideally, if we want certain results, right, we have got to sustain those. We've got to move closer and closer to ideal behaviors. So if that's the case, then it's understanding where those ideal behaviors come from and how we align those ideal behaviors to our systems that begins to become important to us. So the next insight is systems drive behaviors. So if you think about your organization and you think about some of the systems that you have in those organizations, and you begin to pick those systems apart and really look at the behavioral results of those systems, we begin to find things like some of these systems actually produce some results that we don't like, that are in conflict with the end result that we want, right? So how do we change that so that the system is producing a result that, or a behavior that gets us the result that is closer and closer to ideal, to what we're looking for, right? To what we want to achieve as our result and the ideal behavior that we know are informed by the principles. Principles inform specific ideal behaviors, right? The deeper we understand the principles, the more we understand the behaviors that we are looking for within an organization. And over time, we begin to understand these behaviors and be able to list these behaviors in a way that we can tie them back to the systems and say which systems are most important for us to create X behavior that we want to deliver the type of result that we're looking for, right? And as we look at our results, and if our results perhaps are not what we want them to be, then how closely are they being driven by the principles, by the behaviors that we want? We all know we can get great results from bad behaviors sometimes, but usually what comes along with that, in most cases, is that they are very temporary. And over time, we can't hold them up because the way in which we got them or the behavior that we had to get them was not anywhere near ideal. So when you look at this model, the other thing that you'll notice is that culture now is in the background. And this is actually subtle, but it's very important, because we can actually guide and direct the culture that we want by the systems that we drive, by our understanding of the principles and the ideal behaviors that they inform, and therefore get the results that we want. So it's building that culture that we want to drive those results that we want become important, and culture is a part of all of this. It's a part of everything. I mean, there's subcultures within each one of our organizations. And all of this, as you look back at your organizations and you begin to look at the model and how the model drives these type of behaviors, it becomes interesting when you start breaking apart some of these systems and looking at the reality of the behaviors that each system is driving, because you begin to discover some things that are going on within your own organization. To that end, we have developed some education around this, and I'm going to let Gerhard spearhead the education part of this.
Before you get to that, can I throw a couple of questions at you?
Absolutely.
We've just had a few really good ones sent in, and I think that this might be an appropriate place to address those. So Patrick asks, can you explain a little bit more about what you mean by systems?
Okay. So when you start looking at the systems that you have in your organization, so you may look at, let's pick some common ones, perhaps an engagement system. That you have for your associates. You may look at and part of that might be your recognition. One of the tools that you have developed in there. There, you know, sometimes there's debate about what's a system and what's a tool. And one of the common ones that's out is when you look at 5S. Are we looking at a system or are we looking at tools? Well, 5S certainly has a lot of tools in it, right? If we look at 5S from the principal level, we look at it just a little bit differently. When we look at 5S and we look at 5S as an aligned system to a principal, the understanding of 5S changes a little bit. I think most of us on this call are familiar with 5S systems that we go out and we look at and we assess perhaps a certain place in our organization to what level of 5S they've attained. And usually that's tied to cleanliness and housekeeping and these type of things. When we look at 5S, we look at a little bit deeper because that's actually only 2S, right? We look at quite a bit deeper and we look at the behaviors that come from that because 5S actually is looking at is a way that we can increase the flow of our organization, right? By making sure that things are available and visuals can be seen as we need to see them so that we can be alerted to problems in the system and those type of things. That is a much different view of 5S than the one I talked about a little bit earlier. So those are some of the types of systems, an example of the type of system that we might look at. But there's a lot of other systems. There's business systems. You know, how do we look at our business systems and what are they, what types of behaviors are they creating for our organizations? Because all of them do, right? The question is what are they creating and what do we want them to create? But there's business systems, there's work systems, there's improvement systems. A lot of what we'll talk about today is improvement systems because that's a lot of what we drive at. But the business systems support that. And sometimes those can be in conflict with what the improvement systems are doing in that. And that comes to light a lot of times when we talk about the accounting system would be a good example of that. When we're looking at it at improvements and we're looking at reducing inventory, for example, that sometimes comes in conflict with our accountants who, when they look at their business system, they say, wait a second, I want inventories because you're lowering the asset side of my balance sheet. And to them, that sparks an alarm until they understand what we're actually doing on the other side in the improvement systems. And so that's just a look at how these systems have to work together. But these are the types of systems that we're talking about, you know, and I guess there you can look at many of them and say, well, is this a system or is this a tool? And to me, the debate between that is less relevant than looking at what behavior is it driving? What behavior is it driving into our culture? And how are we going to be able to change that to move closer and closer to the ideal behavior that we want that's going to sustain the results that we want. Well, sorry, that was a long answer to a short question, but I think Gerhard's got something to add to that too.
I could give you a couple of quick ideas on systems that drive inappropriate behavior, and I'm just giving Sean a chance to think a second here, but two of them that come to mind immediately are you know, the budget system that most of the people in the university setting encounter or in governments you know, the use it or lose it type philosophy. I mean, we force people to spend money unnecessarily because of a budget system that will reduce the amount of your budget the following year if you don't spend all that money. That's an example of one that, that drives inappropriate behavior. Another example is a situation where a company, a factory in this case, had quality posters all over the place, and they had all these different quality systems in place. You know, the all the traditional quality banners in the organization, but they could not get the quality of the organization to improve. And just a couple of questions of drill down, and we found out, well, that the measurement system that the employees are measured on is based on number of units produced. If you measure people on what they produce and give them a bonus based on their throughput, quality doesn't necessarily become a factor of that. And so what you ended up with was people pumping out parts, irregardless of what the quality of that part was, because the banners do not pay the paycheck. And so that, again, is another example of how a system drove an inappropriate behavior. And I'll give it back to Sean.
No, absolutely. So there's, you know, and I know as you go out and you begin to look at the different systems and tools in your organization, you'll begin to see some of these and how robust the system actually is in many cases. And do the systems look different in the service industry? Well, of course they do. You know, and flow looks different in the service industry, but as we look and we understand each one of these principles and that, we can certainly look at any industry and be able to tie that to that industry. It just looks a little bit different, but it does exist within them. So let me turn the time over now to Gerhard, and we will of course take on more questions as they come along. So even if we have surpassed the topic that we might have been talking about, if you thought of something and you want to bring that up, please bring it up, and Dom will bring that question to us. So let's go to the next slide, and let's let Gerhard cover a little bit of what we're doing on education to this end to be able to bring this understanding deeper into organizations.
Great. I, as you know, as the Shingo Prize organization grew into the Shingo Institute, part of the trigger for that was the need for and the constant demand for more training. I mean, all these concepts were great, and we were evaluating organizations on them, but they wanted more in-depth understanding of what it is that we're expecting out of them. What kind of behaviors and principles are we looking for? What is this cultural shift? And we found that, and Sean already mentioned, that the sustainment is a key issue. We have organizations that are building appropriate systems, but they're not sustaining. They're not staying there with the organization. And part of that is, of course, that cultural shift. So all of that together drove a strong request for us to build an educational program that would help organizations, enterprises, achieve this level of excellence that has sustainment. And so what we did was we took that pyramid that you see over on the right-hand side of the slide. We took that pyramid and we built some courses around that. And two major program areas were developed. One was a Shingo MBA, and then the other is a series of affiliate courses based on that pyramid. Now we have, at this point, we have four different programs, four different classes. The first one is called the Discover class, and it is really an overview class of the entire pyramid. It goes through what are those principles. You see in each of the dimensions there, you see like on the bottom one, you see cultural enablers, and then you see two principles: lead with humility, respect every individual. So what does that mean? What does lead you with humility look like? What kind of behaviors, what kind of system support lead with humility? And that's what's in those courses. And again, continuous improvement, and there's five principles in there and so on. So we have a course that's called the Discover course, which does the overview of all those principles and all those dimensions in that pyramid. And then we go through and we have a second course which talks about just the cultural enablers. And in each of these courses, and this is an important part, each course is a two-day course. The second day of each of those courses is spent doing what it is that we learn in the class on the first day. So again, the first day is a classroom setting, going through and understanding what the principles are, what are we looking for in an organization. The second day is actually walking out on a production floor, or as if it's a hospital in a medical setting or in an office, whatever the setting is, we walk out on the floor and work with the people on the floor to help the students understand how these transformations, these appropriate transformations, can occur.
Gerhard,
okay,
can we get you to speak up just a little bit?
Oh, sorry. The first course was, again, the Discover course. The second course is the Cultural Enablers course. The third course is the Continuous Improvement. The fourth course is Enterprise Alignment and Results. It combines both of those dimensions into one course. Now, we've also been receiving, just over the last year, we've received a lot of pressure and demand to create a course that says, how do you execute and implement all of those? And so we are adding another course, which is called a Deploy course. So in total, there will be five courses that teach and exercise and use those principles on each of those dimensions and teach you how to execute and apply those. Those are taught, as I said, through affiliate organizations. We don't teach them ourselves here, but we have a series of affiliates, and you can get that information, who those affiliates are, on our website. We do teach the MBA cohorts that teach those classes, but that's part of the university setting. In the future, we will be doing some additional programs, which include an executive overview, which is about a 15 to 20 minute overview of this model. And we'll also be doing what we call an associate overview, which is more along the lines of 2 hours. But both of those overviews are not intended at all to replace the courses. The courses will actually get you out on the floor doing, and therefore having a deeper understanding of what each of the principles are. I will turn it back over to Sean, and he's going to go through some of the Shingo Prize benefits and to drill down a little deeper on that.
Tom, did you have any questions for us at this point? Or?
Yeah, there's a few good ones. Let's just take a couple before we go on. This is a good one regarding the order of the guiding principles and how to approach them. The question is, in your experience, has there been a more effective method than others in terms of the sequence you approach them in?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's complex in nature, but let me tackle that to start with, because there are several things to consider when we answer that question, right? One, each organization's approach is going to be a little bit different because each organization's culture is a little bit different. So hopefully that makes sense to everyone. So when I look at these and I look at the pyramid and I look at the dimensions, a few things to consider. One is you can have great tools, and I'm talking now about improvement tools and improvement systems. So that would be within the second dimension here. You can have great tools and systems in place, but you cannot fully leverage those tools and systems in place unless you have the enablers also well embedded. And that's easy to see, right? If we're not if you don't have approach it with humility and respect for individuals, then that's not to say we won't get results. The question is, how good will the results be that we get? Because we can all think of instances where that kind of gets muddied, where our improvement systems kind of get muddied because we're more telling people what to do than we are teaching them, and building a learning organization that can truly problem solve for the for themselves. So that's one thing to look at when we're approaching this. The next thing so in that case, to get the full benefit, we've got to have the enablers well embedded in place, right? The next thing to look at is, are the improvement systems that we have in place aligned to the goals that we're trying to do as an organization? Are they aligned to what we're trying to achieve? Because if they're not, well, it's very true, we may be, what's the best way to put this? Probably artificially making progress that we think we're making, when in fact, we're doing things that may look good, but it's not forwarding or achieving any of the goals that we have laid down for ourselves as an organization. That becomes problematic. So, because remember, in the end, as I spoke earlier on, we're after results. So if we're not actually getting the results that we're after, there's something wrong. Go ahead.
Yeah, one addition to that is that I went into the Air Force at one time, and I was sitting there with a general, and he was saying, you know, we've been doing lean activities for the last 10 years or whatever, and I don't know if we've improved anything. And the bottom line was the activities that are being executed, are they focused on, you know, strategically on the goals of the organization, which is what exactly Sean was saying. Most organizations that we get involved in are strong in that continuous improvement dimension. They're doing a lot of improvements, but it's not sustaining. It's not focused on the culture or the strategic direction of the organization. That's what the rest of those dimensions, the rest of those principles drive towards. It's not just about running a lean event, which is in the continuous improvement section. It's about the overall culture of the organization in total. And so, yeah, a lot of people are doing that second dimension, but they're not building that full pyramid, and that's the problem.
Right, exactly. So, sorry, again, a long answer to a short question, it seems like, but it is one that people ask often, because as you can see from the pyramid, it's in no means meant to be a linear progression. It doesn't quite work that way, because the other thing about the principles and about behaviors is they overlap each other. They're not mutually exclusive of each other. So they all work together. Of course, that makes it a little bit more complex. But nonetheless, that's how we have to attack it, and how we have to look at it. So something we're doing down in the enablers may be impacting our ability to move forward with an improvement system, for example. Our ability to move forward with that improvement system may also be hampered because it's not aligned to one of the objectives that we're doing. We're not getting the results that we truly need out of it. So those are things to consider when you're responding to the question that you asked. But
excellent.
I hope that answered.
This one comes from Margaret. She asks, she's referring specifically to the term that we use, principles. And her question is, can the word values be used interchangeably with the word principles in this case?
So that's an interesting question, and actually one that we addressed a lot. So let me take that briefly, because again, this is, what's most important is, like the conversation with tools and systems. With tools and systems, we want to know what the behavior is that we're getting out of them, rather than have the debate about what's a tool and what's a system. Same is kind of true with values and principles. But as you remember, when I talked about principles, I said that principles are timeless, right? They're universal, right? And they're self-evident. So let's look at a value for a moment. And let's just, there's one time I printed off a list from the internet with about 370 values. So let's just look at one that we all understand, ethics. And that's probably all very close to us right now in the environments that we're in and in the businesses that we're in. But do we all understand ethics exactly the same as each other? We don't, right? We all have a little bit different view of what's good ethical behavior and what's bad ethical behavior. So a value can become subjective if we don't all understand it properly. And this is where we can tie it to a principle. Because again, what we're after, be it values or be it principles, we're after ideal behavior, and the principles tell us what the ideal behavior is. So are values important? Absolutely. They're absolutely important. And most organizations that we go to have a nice list of what they value. The question is does everybody interpret that value the same way? Are our behaviors consistent with our values? Do we even know what our ideal behaviors are to be consistent with those values? So are they the same thing? No, they're not the same thing. But they're very, very closely related. How's that for, hopefully explaining your question? But you can get into long discussions on that. And I think it's just more valuable to really understand the behaviors that are associated with them. And again, we can tie the values very easily back to principles and strengthen them and make the behavior more consistent. Anything you wanted to add to that? So hopefully that answered it. Did you have another one, Dom? I think that was your first one.
Yeah, here's another one. This comes from John, and this refers to, you talked about results and ideal behaviors, and he would like you to define the word ideal.
Yeah, so good question, right? Especially when it comes to results. One of the things we look at with results, most organizations, when they look at, let's just take revenue projections as a result that they look at, they usually look at what they can attain, what they feel they can attain, and then they look at what a stretch goal is, right? Well, we would call the stretch goal much closer to ideal, right? Ideally, we want to be out in front of our competition, right? We want to be producing the revenue that we need to sustain our organization, in this case, the revenue. In other cases, it might be expenses or whatever the metric is, whatever the result is that we desire. When we look at we would also call those results, or those most people call them KPIs. We would call those the lagging indicators. So that's our ultimate goal, right? And funny enough, each year, depending on the organization, that ideal or that stretch goal or that ultimate target, as far as results, changes a little bit because we better understand our business. We get better. We improve. We make improvements. When we look at ideal behaviors are dictated by our understanding of the principle, just like I talked about 5S a little bit earlier. But there are ideal behaviors that we expect to be happening when we talk about a system. So let's look at a quality system that we all might have in our organizations. What do you expect from your quality system? Well, ideally, you would expect certain things like any defect or any error that occurs would become visual to everybody that it impacts. How does that happen? Many different ways, right? But ideally, that would become visual, and there would be certain behaviors around what happens when that does become visual. Is the work stopped? Does the operator or the manager or whoever is in charge of it, do they know to stop the work? That's a behavior you would expect. Ideally, right? We're not all at that point in our organizations, we move toward the ideal, right? We don't go from, sorry, you can't see my hands. We don't go from where we are today, our current reality, to ideal in one jump. It happens in increments, right? But ideally, that's what we'd want to see. We'd want to see the work stop. We'd want to see the problem solved. How do we tackle that problem? How do we all gather around that problem? Is it a team event? Is it engaging to all the people that are affected by it? Those are some of the ideal behaviors that are consistent with that type of a principle about quality at the source, right? So, and there are others. There are many other behaviors, but there are key behaviors that we look for in each one of these principles. So the principle informs those ideal behaviors, and that is why it is so important to deeply understand the principle and to understand how that principle ties to the organization and works, as I said earlier, with other principles. What are the overflows? How can some things in another system impact the system that I'm trying to drive this behavior in? Because there can be conflict between them, and we need to know that too. So I hope that answered that question toward ideal, because that is a very important one. There are a set of ideal behaviors. Will we improve those as we learn more? Absolutely, and especially the key ones. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that later as we get on to some of the research that we're doing and what we're looking at. But absolutely, no different than every organization out there. We become better at what we do as we learn new things, and we will constantly make improvements to our products, to our education, and to our research as we learn and develop these. You know, hopefully that's what everybody out there is doing as well. That's extremely important to what we're doing here. Is there another question on
I've got lots, so stop me when we need to move on. So Heidi is asking, isn't 5S more of a tool used as part of a lean management system, visual management, huddles, coaching, etc.?
Absolutely. See, this is where you can easily get into this debate about, is it a system? Is it a tool? The bottom line is, what matters most is, what behavior are we getting out of our folks? Whether, regardless of what we call it, don't get caught up in the semantics of what it might be, because in the end, it's the behavior that matters. If we have that as part, as a subsystem, as part of a larger system, fantastic. If we call that a tool to this system, that's great. What's most important is, what results are we getting? What behaviors are we getting out of that system? And then we can begin to adjust those systems as we need to move closer and closer to the ideal. Absolutely, that's a perfect example of how we can look at a tool differently. We can call it a system, we can call it a subsystem. Again, don't get tangled up in that. Do get tangled up in what it's producing behaviorally for your organization. Are we getting the results of?
To support that, in the 5S example, we don't want 5S to be something that you go out and you do once every couple of years and run around and mess up the shop floor or whatever, the office, and then go away and forget all about it. We're talking about sustained behavior, and that's exactly what Sean is emphasizing here. It's not an occasional thing, it's a continuous thing.
That's right. So if you look at it as a tool that you use in part of the improvement system, fantastic, because what ties heavily to 5S? Standard work. We've got to have standard work. We've got to have standard work to sustain it. There are many things that tie into each other. So again, I can't overemphasize your ability to look at what the behaviors are that are being created, because that begins to dictate to you the sustainability of the results that you're getting. And are you getting the results that you want, and are they aligned with the objectives?
Great. I just wanted to ask, Kyla asks a question that is relevant to this particular topic. So just one more before we move along, if that's all right.
No problem, and I'll try and shorten my answer.
Okay, terrific. Kyla asks, when driving to ideal behaviors from a culture standpoint, what's the best way to approach individuals who are actively resistant to change, regardless of how you try to engage them in the change?
Wow. Okay. So that's a pretty, and Gerhard, I know, will have some input into this because he's very experienced in going into organizations and changing their culture. And these are commonly the people that, you know, in some publications are called antibodies and we all know that if we can convert them over, if we can engage them at the level that they need, that they actually become some of our most important allies and supporters and advocates of what we are doing. So it depends on the reason. I mean, just like our culture, individuals also depend on, you know, what's the root cause of why they're you know, being contrary to what we're trying to do. And that's different, you know, frankly, for every individual. Unfortunately, that also dictates how we tackle that kind of problem. You know, so there's a variety of ways and approaches to these folks, but engagement, I know, is a big one. If somebody is truly engaged and the purpose that they are working for is so relevant to them that and so important to them that they want to be a part of that, then it's hard to slow people down sometimes when that's the case. And many times we feel that they're engaged, but engagement is sometimes only physical, right? It's only with their hands and that, but it's not always with their mind and with their heart. And most importantly, it's got to be with their heart and their mind and that they are truly involved and in that way engaged with the work that they do. But I'll let Gerhard add a little bit here just so I don't take up more time.
I can, you know, I'm sure that to me that the answer to that question is in training, but that sounds a little bit generic. People don't understand what you're trying to accomplish, and that's usually the foundation for resistance. And you know, I can bet that almost everybody on this call has probably been in a lean event where there was somebody in that event that was sitting back saying, "This is a total waste of time. I don't know why you're using me here. Why I got work to do," that kind of a thing. And by the time that lean event is over, that person is probably so involved and so engaged that you can't hold them down in their seat anymore. I would bet most of you have experienced that. And that's really the kind of thing we're talking about here as well.
Yeah.
They don't see the full benefit of it. And once they do, it's hard to keep them back. So to me, that's that training or orientation that is the biggest resistance. My answer is get them into.
Yeah, let me just add one more thing to that. I know we're quickly running out of time here, and I hope that all of you, you know, will feel free to use this as a resource for these type of questions. But, you know, to add on to the training just a little bit, it's the approach. Even training can be approached in different ways. You know, so if I approach, for example, let's just take a simple one. If I approach standard work, and I'm talking to you about standard work, and my approach is, listen, we've got to have everything documented so that anybody that comes and does this job can do it exactly like you do it. And, you know, that's why we need this standard work done. What am I thinking as an individual? I'm thinking, where am I going? Why are you needing somebody else to come in and do the work that I've done with you for so long? As opposed to the standard work approach that is, you know, listen, we need to get all of these down so that we know how to improve the work to make it easier for you, to make your work easier so that we can utilize you in other ways that you can help us in our processes. But we can't do that until we know exactly where to make the improvements, and we can't do that unless we're doing things the same way each time, so that we know how to improve the work as we move along to make your job easier, to make it less stressful, and to make sure that every time you can be assured that we're giving you quality product
and you're putting out something quality on the other end. Two very significantly different approaches. So I think a lot of it, as Gerhard said, rests in the training and the approach to the training when it comes to that. So Dom, I know we're on time, so I'll move on and I'll try and shorten up just a little bit so we have a little bit of time for questions at the end. The next thing I really wanted to address, we've kind of gone through the model, albeit in brief. The Shingo Prize, as I said earlier, is an excellent way to have a third party look at where you feel you're at and where you feel your reality is. To us, the prize really is the results that you're getting or the KPIs that you're achieving through the transformation of your organization. But the challenge for the prize is a way to validate that. It's a way to say, one, our internal assessment system is working. It has not become watered down. It has not become polluted with the politics that sometimes enter into our internal assessment programs. It's a great way to, on average, we have 5 examiners that go into organizations. How many times do you have five people that are very extremely well experienced and versed in this methodology come into your organization and provide you feedback on how you might be able to close some gaps in that? Not very often in most cases. So it's a great way to validate that. It's a great way to have a target to look for so that everybody can look toward that target. And done properly, that's what it becomes for an organization. It becomes a goal and a point for people to look at and to shoot for and to rally around. So those are some of the things that it can do for your organization. It exposes gaps. You learn things. I've been told by organizations, one of the processes within the challenge is developing an achievement report. I've been told by some organizations that that's one of the most valuable things that they walk through because it forced them to look at their organization, what behaviors they had in their organization, what was the scope of those behaviors, how did it proliferate the organization. It forced them to do that, and for many, that's not a common exercise that you sit down and do. But again, I want to emphasize that the key things to get are the results, and we want to make sure that everybody knows that because those are most important to your organization. The other thing that we have developed, and this goes along with our research, it's called Insight, and Insight is an online assessment that is now available. It's very inexpensive. And we've intentionally made it so because it's part of collecting data, which I'll talk about again here in research. But it's an online tool that's used to do a survey of your organization. It's aligned with the principles. It's aligned with some of the systems that we talked about so that we could come back and begin to expose gaps that way before we even talk about, in some cases, coming in and doing a challenge. But it is part of our assessment process. It's part of the challenge, but it can be done separately as well. And it's a great tool to be able to expose that. And we've had many conversations with organizations as we went through the beta on this about the types of gaps that it exposes. And we're going to learn more about this as it goes on, and I'll get a little bit more into that as we talk about the research. Another thing that we've been doing for organizations just recently, because we just launched it this year, is we actually have a Shingo MBA program here at the university. It's the full MBA program with the Shingo emphasis on it that carries all of our training along with it, all of the methodology that we have developed here, along with all of the traditional MBA, probably with a little bit more of a slant toward the Shingo and the lean operational excellence side of things. It's a 15-month program. It is a combination of online work, of project work, and of classroom work. And that classroom work is done here one weekend a month, Thursday through Saturday. But there's more information on that if you want to go to the education link on our website. You can get more information on that. The other thing that we're doing, and this is really exciting when I talk about the research side of things, because with the research now, we're changing the guidelines a little bit, and you'll see those come out. These are for the challenges that come in that apply for the research prize. We're changing it a little bit and focusing dramatically on impact and the impact of the research that is done. So you'll see those changes. Most of you are familiar with many of the publications that we have awarded in the past, but we're also currently working on our own research. And this is what Insight is providing us. It's providing us data points so that what I'm hoping in the future is, one, we're going to learn a lot of things that we had no idea about when it comes to principles and behaviors and systems, in the sense of what impacts systems most. What type of behaviors do we need to get in place that will impact our systems most? Wouldn't it be great if I could come back and talk to you in a couple of years and be able to have the same type of webinar around Insight and be able to say, listen, if you want this principle, if you want this type of result, you need to be looking at this type of behavior that is tied to this principle with these type of systems, because through our experience and through our data, this is what research tells us will move you closest toward the results that you want and move your behavior more closely to the ideal behavior. That's what we're hoping to explore. That's what we're working on right now, exploring. And those are some of the results that we're looking at as we move forward. Even in the short time that we've been working on this with researchers and organizations, we know that one of the key issues or key systems with involvement is that the more people are tied to the purpose of the organization, the more committed they are to that purpose, the higher their engagement. We've seen that time and time again, and purpose outweighs many things when it comes to engagement of our associates in that. And sometimes that seems like, well, yeah, that seems obvious, right? But this is what the research is telling us as well. So now the question becomes, how do we get our purpose within our organization so tied to each individual in our organization that they want to work, that it becomes their mission, right? That becomes their mission and that becomes their vision for the organization. And so those are the type of systems that we begin to work on when we know that the data tells us that. So this is a very important part of what we're doing. It will tie into publications that we will be putting out in the future, hopefully in the form of journals. But again, to provide you with the information and the data to support some of the things that you want to do in your organizations. And finally, as we end up, and I think, Dom, I don't have a lot more time here, I want to make sure that you have a good understanding of what our conference is like, because I think our conference is a little bit different, perhaps than many, because it does address all these things that we've been talking about. You have the opportunity to network with organizations that are currently doing this type of work in their organization, that are currently working on how do we take the model and embed it into what we're doing. How do we tie in those values that were talked about earlier? Because we want you to keep those values. We just want to strengthen them. How do we do that? How do these organizations do it? How do they embark on moving closer toward ideal behavior? So you get to network with those type of organizations. You get to meet the affiliates that work with us in delivering some of the education that that Gerhard was talking about. And how do they do that? And where do they work? And what have they seen within the industries and the work that we're doing? Same is true with the speakers. The speakers we carefully select from organizations that are engaged in this work. Many of them are from recipient organizations that have challenged for the prize. I hope to see you all there. I hope if you have any questions, you use us as a resource. And Dom, if you have other questions for us, Gerhard and I can certainly take them.
Okay.
I don't know what our time constraints are.
Well, we have most of our attendees are sticking with us. So if you gentlemen have time, I'll just take a few of these questions. One of them is we've had several that are very similar in nature, and so I'm going to kind of conglomerate them together. Let's take this one from Josh, for example. He says, I'd like to persuade my organization to pursue the Shingo Prize. What's my first step? Others have asked, you know, how do I get started? What are the steps I need to take to get moving on that?
Well, the first thing is, we cover this with every organization, and you'll see it in the guidelines also, is getting a deep understanding of what our model is, how we assess things, how we look at things, so that you can have a very realistic feel for where your organization is at, and how you can begin to close those gaps. Because the bottom line really is that I think when and most of the questions that come to us, and this is not dissimilar, come to us and is how do I influence leadership, right, to pursue this? And leadership has to see a return on investment, right? That's what we all look for, is what is my return on investment? If I'm going to spend the time, I'm going to spend the resources and the dollars to do this, I want to make sure that I get a return on investment. So clearly understanding what that return is very important. And we've mentioned some things here, but a clear understanding of that and the value that is derived from that is important. And I think you gain a lot of that through our education. Organizations that do not go through a certain level of our education sometimes struggle with the outcome of the assessment and that, because they don't truly understand what it is that we do and how we look at organizations and how we assess organizations. And it's different than many, because we look at behaviors. We look at the robustness of a system based on the behaviors that it produces and the results that it produces. When you begin to understand that and you're able to articulate that to leadership, I think it changes the game on how you're able to influence them. But again, in the end, it's return on investment. It is for all of us.
I think of a couple of examples of companies that have just started down that road recently, and they started with their lean leads taking the Discover course, which we mentioned, which is the overview course of that entire principles. They took that course, and then they took what they learned from there and brought it back to their leadership and got their leadership excited about it. And the companies I'm thinking about, they've got the president coming to the conference to hear what other people think about this. And that is really the test. Do they believe what these other people are preaching at the conference? Sean didn't mention it, but at the conference itself, a front end to that conference is the opportunity to take a couple of these courses that we talked about here.
That's right.
So, you know, you can tie it together with the conference, but that seems to be the inroad, is that the Discover course, which kind of gives you the overview and shows you the benefits and the opportunities for improvement, and then taking that back to your leadership.
Yeah, and it gives you a little taste of
in Discover in particular, gives you a little taste of what does that look like operationally? What does that look like when I go out to a shop floor or an office or wherever the Gemba visit might be? You've got to influence leadership, and it becomes part of the path. No different than the question we get on, when they look at this, it's about sustainment. It's about making their job easier because you're now sustaining those results that are so coveted to every organization. You've got to have them. How do we make that easier? How do we make it easier for everyone to see? Well, you make it easier by using everybody in the organization, and that's where behavior comes to, and that's where culture comes to.
Terrific. There's another one. A few people have asked. I'll use Heidi's because it articulates it well. She asks, when the top leaders request a business case for implementing lean management system or using the Shingo model, how do you present or show examples of positive ROI when there are competing initiatives that compete for resources?
Yeah, there are competing initiatives, and so what's really important is understanding what the specific leader, whoever it is, what their business case is. What is it that they want to move? What measures that they want to move? Because you're right, if your business case is that you're trying to increase sales and we're down talking about something perhaps in production, well, okay, it doesn't, they're conflicting. It's not meeting what they desire, right? So you do have to know the business case. And you do have to, I believe, you have to, find somebody that can influence them in that direction. In other words, if you're going to influence a CEO in that, then you're probably going to need them talking to other leadership from other companies, from other organizations that have gone on this path. And that's the reason we do a lot of our study tours and these type of things, right? Is so they can begin to explore this. They can see organizations that are doing it. They can ask those questions that are in line with their business case instead of me as their associate trying to present something that may not be in line. I have to know what their business case is. But once you do know that, you can certainly influence that, and you can find other leaders, you can find authors. And this is part of, again, why, I can't overemphasize the conference, because these are the type of things we have at the conference. We have authors, we have the people that have written the books, we have the organizations that are doing it within their organizations, and it gives them no different than this person that Gerhard was talking about. It gives them the opportunity to talk to these people and get their questions and concerns answered. Because as much as the successes are important, they also want to know, what are the stumbling blocks? What am I going to run up against? How painful is this track going to be? Because it's not easy, but nothing is, right? Everything you're doing right now, I mean, if you happen to be in an organization that's, we commonly refer to as a firefighting organization, right? Where everything that's brought to us, we deal with the current problems because that's all we have time to deal with because we've never fixed them. That's not easy either. That's hard too. So the whole idea behind this is making people's jobs easier, making those results easier. But yes, it does take influence. There's no doubt about it. I don't want to make that sound like that's an easy thing to overcome, because it's not always. There are many organizations that it hasn't been overcome with to date, even though they have some facilities that are showing great results, that are very successful, they still haven't been able to influence the organization as a whole, even showing those great KPIs.
Yeah, just to build on that and to add on that, we do help. I've had a couple of requests, and what we've done is we've had CEOs or presidents get on the phone with other companies of similar size, similar structure, and they have the conversation with them. Often the question is not so much, is Shingo the right thing to do, but is how in the heck do I get this thing executed in my organization? And those are usually the more interesting conversations. But anyway, yeah, we have helped, you know, to have one-on-one conversations or to have site visits where you actually go tour a facility that's done this. But I think to Sean's point, the conference is actually a much better way to go because you don't talk to just one person or one organization. You got the chance to, you know, to rub elbows with a lot of different organizations. So anyway.
Yeah, and again, back to my point earlier, because you made a good point, right? We want to develop all this material, all this research, all of the work that we do to make your organization better, irregardless of whether you challenge for the prize or not. We just think that's a, you know, there are benefits to doing it, but we have many more organizations that work with us than challenge for the prize. Many, many, many more. You know, so I really need to emphasize that the prize is getting your KPIs and working closer to toward those ideal behaviors that we all need and want. Right?
Terrific. You gentlemen have been very generous with your time already. I wonder if I could just ask one last question before we close.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely.
This one is from Alicia, and she says she's just finished her MBA, and she's wondering if there's a way to receive a Shingo certificate.
Good question. And the answer is yes, there is. And if you'll just rather than explaining the whole process on that, if you'll send us an email, I'll get you to the right person that can help you along that road. But the answer is yes, there is.
Terrific. Well, thank you so much for your time and wisdom, gentlemen, and we'll go ahead and close this. I just want to close by saying that you can feel free to email questions to us and also visit shingo.org for information on challenging for the Shingo Prize, finding out when upcoming Shingo workshops are, learning about the Shingo Conference, which is coming up, and we hope to see many of you there. Or learning more about the Shingo model. Once again, thank you for attending, everyone, and we hope to be in continuous touch with you. Thanks.
Thank you. Hope to see you all soon.
Thanks a lot.